Well, thank you for the invitation. Welcome all our guests from abroad. I see that you're putting the slide on. I will share with you some thoughts on the process of innovations with specific emphasis on interventions, which has been my field over the years. I have to disclose that I'm co-founders of a couple of companies and also on the board of director of the Rappaport Research Institute of the Technion and BioRap, which is the applied technology company of that institution. I want to share with you the enthusiasm that I used to share on the Nobel laureates of the Technion, the two of them, Hershko and Chekhanover, in 2004 when I was serving as dean of the Faculty of Medicine, and the current one, Professor Schechtman in chemistry, who just won the last Nobel in chemistry out of Technion in metallurgy. So it's really been a great honor to us in Haifa and to Israel in general in science. Israel and innovation, life science, is quite unique. And this is a slide that was given to me by Peter Fitzgerald in one of our meetings. It's number one in patents per capita in the world. It has some 750 life science companies on overall around 7 million people, equal to the Silicon Valley. It has the same number of companies as the Silicon Valley with 20 times less money than the Silicon Valley. It has already second generations entrepreneurs already, and this is what Peter said, it's a natural spirit, focus, and chaos, which is a power which is very important in the innovation process. Number one in medical innovation, in medical patents per capita, I mentioned that. In biopharma, fourth in biopharma in number of patents, so also biopharma, we share a very respectable place in the world. And if we look at Israeli life science industry in sectors, you can see here that the majority in red is medical devices. And if you see the different development phases, you see that there's quite a large number of companies that have reached a revenue phase that is not really sold out or, as we say, exited before reaching revenues. If we look at the main medical fields that we see, it's the cardiovascular and peripheral vascular, which is the number one in number of companies, followed by general health, oncology, and other devices and other fields. I'm from Haifa, for those of you who come from abroad, but all of you know that we share on the same campus the Faculty of Medicine and the hospital together, and this is really a great advantage, as is also shared by other institutions like Hadassah and I think that Be'er Sheva, that you have all on the same spot, sharing innovations, thought, and specifically at our place, we have the Technion engineering, which is very strengthens our tendency for innovations. And we see here that we are also a great believer in the fact that scientists, physicians, and engineers, together with the industry, can really lead to innovations. Let's go a little bit to what drives innovations, what drives medicine in general. I think that really medicine is driven over the many decades by science and technology. Technology-driven changes in healthcare will continue even at a faster rate in the future, despite the economic and regulatory constraints. And individual innovators, academia, industry, and financial bodies, and the regulatory agencies has all critical roles in this process. Biomedical science and technology is also an engine for economic growth. I'll give you some examples of really historical landmarks in this field, and I'll go very quickly since I know that we're short in time. We see here Forssman, we see here Mirovsky, and we see here also Andreas Grunzig. Forssman was really a pioneer in actually, cath was born by his first invention where he cathed himself in 1929, and he actually, after his really courageous deed, which was partially insane, Well, he was actually, as you all probably know the story, after he actually did that, he was given an unpaid position at Berliner Charité Hospital for a couple of years to keep this very innovative but crazy physicians in-house. But later he was thrown out of this hospital, and he was, I mean, he was told, you certainly can't begin surgery in that matter. And he was actually forced to quit cardiology and go to urology. Even when he got the later, 26 years later, he got the Nobel, he was still serving as the honorary professor of surgery and urology at the University of Mainz. So I think that's a really historical lecture that you can spend hours on this issue. From our side, somebody who passed through Israel, Michel Mirovsky, I think he stayed in Israel for a year or two on the way to Baltimore with a dream for a defibrillator in his head. And he was really a pioneer that together with Morton and Meyer, he made the defibrillator. And I think we all know and we honor him by the Mirovsky Award in this society. Who is an innovator? He can be a clinician scientist, a practicing clinician, a nurse practitioner, he can be an engineer, can be others, can be anybody. But it's very interesting to see what the history of the Royal Society, Thomas Spratt, Bishop of Rochester, tells about it. Invention is a heroic thing and placed above the reach of the low and vulgar genius. It required a bold and nimble, a restless mind, a thousand of difficulties with which a mean heart will be otherwise broken. So a mean person is broken by innovation, according to the British Society, Royal Society. Another major innovator, Andreas Grunzig, with a dream to open an artery in an awake patient, opened the field of angioplasty and interventional cardiology, later to followed by Palmaz and Schatz with stents. Obviously, I think if we look at the field of interventional cardiology, in cardiovascular disease, if we look at the last three or four decades, new technologies have completely revolutionized our ability to treat patients. Balloon stents, drug-eluting stents, valvular interventions, imaging navigation has exceeded our wildest imaginations. Became the standard of care today. We all, people at our age, went through that process, and we started, there was nothing. So it's really an amazing and a great privilege to go through such a dynamic period. I'll skip through that. I'll just mention some of the things that we did here in Israel. This is something I did more than 10 years ago with the initial era of stenting with bare metal stents. This is an instant company, a very early designs of a coil stent later on with a B-stent that is now already history. But I think that Israel really shared the initial part of stenting to be followed by newer inventions, by instant, by near. And the Medinal company, the near stent with the Richters and many other devices. This was followed by a whole revolution in the first and then second and third generation drug-eluting stents, and I will not go into that in details, just to mention another new idea which we are now playing with, which is a stent which is covered by an enzyme that generates NO from the blood. It's actually it's a drug factory on stents. It's a concept of a stent that has a factory that generates NO, which is anti-proliferative and anti-smooth muscle proliferation, as well as smooth muscle relaxant. So that's a very interesting concept. I think that if we look at, there are many major Israel innovations, but I'll try to see what we have in, I think that really what is well known in Israel is the in Teva industry in drugs, Copaxone and Azilect has been really, and other drugs that has come also from Hebrew University have been really a breakthrough in the medical pharmacology here in Israel. In stents, I mentioned that. I think BioSense is very important in mentioning. given imaging, not in our field, but I think it's really revolutionizing the GI diagnosis. And I have to mention Vento. We talked about TAVI today, and I'll mention that. This is also related to stenting. Current, there are many, there are a more, there are hundreds of companies, and among them, I think dozens of companies in cardiology, in stent-related or other related issues that are now underway, and it's not impossible to cover them all. If we look at the major, I think one of the most important Israeli development is BioSense, really developed by Shlomo Ben Chaim, and Lior Gebshen was a PhD student at that time, but really opened the field of three-dimensional mapping of electrophysiology in the heart. I think it opened the whole field of electrophysiology in the world, and at that time it was founded in Haifa in 1993, and it was actually sold to J&J in 1998. This is record time from founding of a company to having it sold, so it's really an amazing thing, being able to map the heart for treat arrhythmias, move from diagnosis to therapeutics, which is a very important part of it, and be able to ablate, and then be able to incorporate additional imaging and do multi-dimensional imaging. So I think it's a major, had a major and continues to have a major impact on the field of electrophysiology in the entire world. In the field of imaging, I want to mention the hybrid imaging system, developed also at Rambam Bar, our group of the nuclear imaging, together with GE. This is the SPECT CT that we now use research-wise to really diagnose complex coronary disease, and the ability to do combination anatomy and perfusion, that's the strength of that. I want to mention very shortly the field of stem cell technology in all directions, which is really where the future is heading. It's very difficult to predict, though, when it will become clinical. I'm sharing with you Professor Itzkovich and Gebstein from our institution, and I think that if you can see here, tissue engineering and other things, the movies doesn't play, but I'll skip that for the sake of time. A landmark paper by the group of Gebstein was really being able to show that the human embryonic stem cells were implanted in a pig heart, in a model of complete heart block, can generate a biological pacemaker, and in 2 weeks can pace the heart. You can see here, using the BioSense system to show that it's really these cardiomyocytes from a pig, from human origin, are pacing the pig heart. It's a landmark study published in Nature. To take it to clinical practice, it's a long pathway, though. I'm not going to go into details. How long does it take to move from in such studies from bench to patients? I think very fascinating direction that we see now is also using the Yamanaka approach in actually generating stem cells from skin or from other types of tissue by implanting four genes in them and making them making a somatic cell into a stem cells, and then being able to transform it in our case to cardiac cells. This is the work of Gebstein, who took actually skin cells, was able to move it to embryonic cells, to differentiate to cardiac cells, really dye it and show the oldest structures in the cardiac cells, map the electrophysiology, and on top of that, when you take these cells from somebody from an inherited cardiac disorders, in this case a long QT, one of the genetic malformation in a single family, you can get these cells to actually, that made from skin cells, to behave like triggered arrhythmia in the dish and select a drug in a specific patients. And this was followed already by other investigators. And I think this is a fascinating tools now to guide our therapy and to make it practical in patients. It's really our challenge for the future. Other companies from Israel, MediGuide, not everything becomes practical on a daily basis very quickly. MediGuide, another navigation system in Israel, was sold to St. Jude 2 years ago. This is a navigation for stenting. Now they're moving it to electrophysiology. We still are waiting to see if it will become practical and reach patient treatment. Also, another development that I was involved with, this is a Technion company, Corindus. Now already it's a robotic catheterization. You can actually do the catheterization using a joystick. You can see it here. You can do everything from balloon to stenting through the joystick. And already, I think in the last ACC, the first in men study, a precise study was published by Weiss and colleagues and showing that really you can get a very high success rate of almost a very low death and MACE and close to 98% success rate, as well as a marked reduction in radiation actually exposure, 94.8 reduction in radiation exposure to the operator, which is sitting in a shielded position. So I will skip TAVI. We talked about TAVI. I think it's really changing our future. And when we see it, how many new devices are actually coming in the way to actually treat valve diseases, including another company that was purchased by Medtronic from here, from Israel, Ventor, it's really mind-boggling to see where this field is going. Using more accurate technology to precise our location with an Israeli company that is helping us to do that, and with also other companies that are worldwide working on trying to improve valve repair. So I think I have to mention also the work of Banai et al. With the Reducer, this concept that if you do stenosis in a coronary sinus, you can improve the perfusion of the myocardium, generate collaterals. Very interesting concept in those patients that you cannot revascularize them from the arterial side. So, I mean, innovations really is almost endless. And for the sake of time, I will move on. And I will also want to say that what we've seen over the last 20 years in cardiology, where we can treat our patients in acute MI very efficiently in the cath lab. As you remember, we all started with thrombolysis and spent a lot of time in these patients in the CCU and improving our thrombolysis rates. And now today we move to almost 100% primary angioplasty where we get there into the right window. And even if we get into a later window, we're going to see probably the same trend in the brain. This is the same type of things, patients that we see in the brain. We're now more into the thrombolysis phase, moving into direct interventions, and I predict that it will reach in 10 years where cardiology is today. I will not go into the different phases for the sake of time of innovations, and there are quite a few rules of how to do innovations and what's successful and what are the rules to success of innovations. But I want to share with you what is the this is one of my last slides, the future of cardiovascular innovations. I think that we really are going to see in the stent area, we are going to see a small optimizing stents directions all the time, better metals, more thinner struts, new ways of drug deliveries, new drugs probably. But in general, these stents are here to stay. They are going to be partially replaced, maybe in very some cases with bioabsorbable stents, but it's unclear where is the role still of bioabsorbable stents going to be here. In terms of, I believe that there will be a more personalized approach to this, to treating patients, not only in respect to drugs and to use of drugs and optimize the use according to genetics to the individual patients, but also maybe to select the device that should be treated and other things. We're just starting to scratch the surface with this genomic, unbelievable technology which is evolving. We can talk about personalized stents. Today, one stent fits all. We have in Israel, we decide whether we put a drug-eluting stents or a bare metal stents, and among the and then talk a little bit about flexibility and coverage and the structures. But really, we haven't personalized stents yet. I believe that valvular transcatheter interventions are here to stay and to expand over the years, and we'll do it as a heart team, as it was suggested by my colleagues before that. I believe that we'll see more navigations and robotics over the next years as technology develops. I believe that CT angio, that is now done in remote places and then discussed and with the interventionalist, which repeat usually the angiograph before the interventions will be here, will become much more accurate. They will be brought into the lab, and I think we can skip in the future. We can make decisions based on CT angio, even on interventions, and not usually guide us on towards the interventions. I believe that acute stroke is something that is going to be dealt with the society, whether it's going to be the cardiologist, the interventional radiologist, or a unique brand of neurologist that would like to join this innovative field. It's yet to be seen. So I just, this is Rambam, this is our innovation tower, and I also invite you all to join our ICI meetings, which takes place every time in December, also this year. Thank you very much.